That was a way too generous introduction from Herb, and it wasn't that long after Herb got here that he and I took our kids camping, if you can imagine that. And we didn't realize you couldn't order a pizza to a campsite at a state fairground, so we had to kind of figure it out. So anyhow, I chose... Yeah, that's me too. We didn't do that well. So anyhow, I chose this topic today because it affects all of you, everyone in the room, either as mentor or mentee, and I would suggest even kind of the senior faculty in front, a mentee relationship, and I clearly still benefit from the input of my teachers. So whether you're a student, a resident, fellow applicant, and welcome to UW, or faculty member, I think this really has relevance to each of you here. You've seen this quote from Halstead before that talked about the system, and the system really started as essentially an apprenticeship and introduced a new model of residency training. But residency training affects both faculty development and student development and training also. I asterisked the woman in there because obviously that wasn't in a Halstead idea. But as you'll see later, in the data part of UW, every single paper I'm going to quote that reflects our data of mentorship has been written by our female resident graduates, and we'll highlight some of the things. And so we're going to move a little bit from motherhood and apple pie to actually hardcore data about this topic to kind of help you think about it. From the business literature, Tom Peters said, leaders don't create followers, they create leaders. And that's really what Halstead was getting at. You may not choose to be a leader for any number of reasons, but everyone that finishes here should have the skill set to go on and further develop their leadership abilities and skills. So the concept of mentor is not new. It came from Homer's Odyssey. Mentor was the teacher of Telemachus, who was Odysseus' son. And his kind of marching orders were these below: reasoning, to teach reasoning, mechanical skills, emotional development, intellectual development, and to serve as a guardian. And that clearly kind of interacts with our thinking of what we do in terms of mentorship and academic surgery, whether you're a faculty member with a resident or with a fellow with a resident, resident with a student, and fourth-year student with third-year students, and on the way down the line. And so these concepts are not new. How we apply them to the modern learning in surgery is what we want to talk about. The sociologists have looked at this, obviously, and there's some kind of important things here with the mentor being a role model or a sponsor, encourager, and the encouragement part's very important, not hollow attaboys, but really how to encourage people, providing both positive and useful negative feedback for someone who's skilled or less experienced. So this, again, you can see transcends any of the number of different relationships in the room. And the key is to promote the person's professional and personal development. I think most successful mentors or people who feel like they have been successfully mentored will realize that this relationship extends outside of the bounds of our professional involvement, and most people would develop a deep friendship with their key mentors. If you're a sociologist, you know, there are 10 stages of mentoring. One is relationship building, and this sounds actually not unlike developing a philanthropic relationship with a donor. And frankly, I was at the KK a couple weeks ago with my son having a beer, and I saw a lot of this going on Saturday night, you know, attraction, cliche exchange. This is like dating, recounting, personal disclosure, bonding in one form or another to develop the relationship. And sometimes that's fairly short order, but that usually takes for a meaningful relationship longer period of time. Just like in development, in philanthropy, but also for mentorship relationships, then there's the stewardship part. And the stewardship part is actually the hard part. The exciting part is developing the relationship. You've all seen that in your romantic encounters, but it's keeping it going where the work really begins, but the key thing to make it work. And these are, again, how sociologists define what happens in good mentoring relationships. This is a picture of the corner of my office. And, you know, it's interesting. My generation has kind of transitioned from having your mentors with photos on the wall, little things they write to you, to not really doing that. And so it's really interesting. I have my general surgery mentors up here, but I don't have my plastic surgery mentors because kind of as I was training and finishing in the early 90s, that just wasn't what we did. And so new faculty offices tend not to have their mentor photographs. But so I've got a couple up there I could talk about. But one I just want to point out is Mark Rowe, who was the chief of pediatric surgery at Pittsburgh Children's when I was a young faculty member. And Mark is one of the people I identified as a mentor, and this was his thing, was developing young people. But he felt that we all have an obligation, as he kind of put down here in the corner, to Mike, carry the message down the line. And that was his single message to everybody who he worked with, and as graduations occurred and people transitioned to their next life. It's our requirement, it's our mandate to share what we know, both surgically and non-surgically, to help people develop. So these are the four specific questions I want to touch on in the next half hour or so. So what are the common characteristics of successful surgical mentorships? And that's kind of the apple pie, Chevrolet, motherhood piece, because no one's really studied that to define what it takes to be a good mentor. And in fact, the talent it takes at different times to be a good mentor does shift. What are the current barriers to being an effective mentor in academic surgery? And there are a ton of them, and frankly, they're getting harder. And then the last two things, particularly for this audience, I want to really focus on, and this will be more the data part of the talk. You know, why is it important to mentor surgery residents and surgery subspecialty residents? And then I'd say probably the most critical thing we do for the future of academic surgery, why do we mentor medical students? And a kind of important thing, as you figure out your role within this topic, is who should do it. I became interested in this topic when I came here from Pittsburgh. There was a excellent clinical residency here, but no one in the history of the residency went into academic surgery. And so one of the goals when I came here was to develop one of the premier training grounds for academic plastic surgeons, adding to the that were clinical. And so we started to look at this. Ben Mandel, a graduate of the general surgery residency here and one of our last independent model plastic surgery residents before we converted to a fully independent program, working with Sharon, Bob McDonald, Carl Gutowski. We looked at a group of residents that preceded our transition to what we describe as our academic residency, where we started formal research conferences. We had requirements for productivity academically in terms of paper writing, participating in meetings. We kind of started a academic curriculum, a business curriculum, and started moving people from training to be excellent clinical plastic surgeons to the potential of being excellent academic plastic surgeons. And it really, when you have this group of talented people in front of you, how do you get them to be the best they can be? How do you help them develop to deliver the things that they are capable of delivering? So we looked at 26 successive plastic surgery grads, again, straddling before we made the transition to an academic career and afterwards. We had a 93% response, so that's about as good as you're going to get on a survey. And we look at the academic residency, which is after we implemented these changes in the clinical residency, and it's really obvious if you build it, they'll come. So as we provided opportunities for academic participation and productivity, people bought into it, participated in it, were productive and successful, and all those in that order is important. And you can see with a really small p-value, that difference became evident, that providing opportunity is a key component of this. In terms of having a formal and an informal relationship with a mentor, it does affect career decision making. I'm going to show you that even more poignantly when that happens fairly early in a residency program in just a little bit. And ultimately, if you provide the opportunity to participate in academics and see the joy and the satisfaction of an academic career, more people will pick that. So we went from 0% of our grads to 38% early in our residency picking in academic careers. And just the baseline of this is 10% of people in plastic surgery go into academics, 90% go into private practice. So we were pretty happy with this sample. That was not statistically significant, as you see, just missed below. So now we are. But it speaks to providing opportunity, providing mentorship and leadership, and then leading people through this process. And these were the two areas that came up as important in terms of how a mentor affect a career path, particularly for academically inclined surgeon, was one is a guide about professional issues, which is mentorship, and this role modeling. Role modeling is not necessarily mentorship, but I think as you'll see in a little bit, role modeling is a key component. So what are the common characteristics of successful surgical mentors? You know, Lance Armstrong, and I have him asterisked here because he's going to be asterisked for life, and he's had a bad week, as you saw. You know, and he had said motivation can't take you far if you don't have the legs. Well, there's different ways to get the legs. He didn't do it kind of the ideal way. But this is actually a true statement. And so the key is you can be motivated to be a good mentor, but you need a certain skill set, which is not necessarily talent or training, but a desire and an understanding of what it takes to be a good mentor over time. So Holt, the ENT surgeon, kind of published this, and this is the motherhood and apple pie piece, of this list of things that it takes to be an ideal role model or a mentor. And you can read through them. I'm not going to read them. And I'm looking at an array of really talented mentors here in front and in back also. And I don't know that anybody ever meets all these. So if you're looking and thinking, oh, God, I'm never going to be that, I'm not that for sure. And so it's really important to figure out what you're good at and what you do here and make it mold and work with your mentor style. Pellegrini, who's at orthopedics chair, kind of described traits of successful and unsuccessful mentors. And while there are skill sets that are important to being good at this, successful at this, in substance, there is never any substitute for substance. Style really matters in this. And so you've got to kind of figure out how to optimize your style. Commitment is obviously key. That goes without saying. You have to accept a beginner. And this has not been easy for surgery, particularly as integrated resonances evolve. Plastic surgery's had integrated resonances for a long time. And, you know, thoracic has recently evolved, vascular surgery a little bit before that. And we now have integrated programs here. And faculty learn pretty quickly early in an integrated program that call's a lot more difficult when the first call is coming to a PGY1 resident than a PGY6 board eligible or board certified general surgeon. So you do have to understand and accept the difference of the trainee at different levels of their experience. Providing instructional support, that kind of sounds obvious. Versatility in different interpersonal constructs. So this can be as simple as, like, I finally had to buy a device that I could text my kids because they don't answer the telephone. But more importantly, this has to do with verbal and nonverbal cues. And when you're meeting with your mentor, you got to figure out what's going on, even if the words don't quite match the face or the context of the conversation. Continuous learning, you know, that's a habit that everyone should establish. And then hope and optimism. I mean, having a positive attitude, being optimistic, is really critical to success in surgical leadership. On the other side, Pellegrini pointed out, here are some things that matter in a negative way. Insecure, poor ego support, not generally a problem with this room. Poor acceptance of the transition of mentee to mentor. And that's what we go at. And there are people who actually don't do that well. And if you don't, you have to appreciate that. If you recognize it, you can work through that. But this is what it's all about. Limited communication repertoire will hurt you in every way in medicine, whether it's with your patients, with your colleagues, with staff. You have to be able to let go, so you can't always be the dominant A-type personality in these relationships, and be willing to let go and celebrate the progress of your protege. You know, I think, like most leaders, you know, nothing makes me happier than to see my residents excel beyond my personal accomplishments, which is, while it's not difficult, that's what the goal is. Willing to let the mentee grow. Now, my kind of number one mentor, if I had to identify him, is Bill Futrell. Bill was an All-American halfback at Duke. He was the chair of plastic surgery. He has the highest track record of conversion of residents to academic plastic surgeons, with 80% of his residents going into academics. Pretty amazing guy. He actually took his fifth year of Division I football eligibility as a first-year medical student, ran in the Sugar Bowl. So incredibly talented person. I was really lucky to train with him. And he is very athletically minded. And people say, how does he do it? Well, he coached. He's like a great coach. And he is. But a coach and a mentor are not the same thing. So having a coach who is a mentor is a good thing, but a coach isn't necessarily a mentor alone, nor is necessarily a mentor coach. And you can kind of see some differences. You know, mentorship is a holistic kind of approach and a holistic focus, where coaching tends to be performance at specific skill sets, specific agenda for coaching, more open agenda, because the needs of your mentees are going to change over time. And facilitating development and listening is particularly important in mentorship, because it's not about you, it's about them. So the whole concept of coach versus mentor, while they're related, don't get them confused that they're the same thing. Chip Shoba has been here, wrote about kind of the key kind of factors here, that it's a long-term relationship. This is not transient for it to be effective or it to be satisfying on both the mentor and the mentee. It can tend to be and should have an informal element, although I'll show you some data in a little bit that suggests that formal mentoring programs are beneficial and desired by residents. There is a mutual trust and commitment, and the mutual part is key. This is a bi-directional relationship. It should be empowering, which is kind of the new approach to mentorship. And in an ideal world, the mentor has an effective history of mentoring. At some point, it's a chicken and the egg. You know, how can you be a good mentor without having a chance to make some mistakes and you become more effective? So the key is figuring out when to jump in the pool, but making sure there's water there ahead of time. Most of the time, you're going to be thrust into mentor-mentee relationships, which you don't even label like that. And you walk away and think that's really what we're talking about here. A paper he wrote a year later looking at the essence of mentoring, again, Chip's writing, you know, this is a trainer and a teacher, you know, not a chauffeur. You're not leading, you're not describing, you're not in a very prescriptive way deciding what's going to happen. Skill set to adopt and succeed through new challenges and unanticipated obstacles. Probably the most important thing you can do for your mentee is to help them prepare for the things that are not anticipated, because those are the things that we all are challenged with, and ultimately with the goal of having an independent mentee. So number two, what are the current barriers to effective mentoring and surgery? Pellegrini, again, looking at challenging work hour limitations are challenges. It changes the relationship. It changes time together. As many of you have seen, some of the best learning moments occur after hours when there's not continuity of care necessarily, where the shift may change. Productivity-driven compensation, which is becoming de rigueur at most medical centers, affects one's ability to be available and changes some of the emphasis on a day-to-day basis, how you spend your time. There's training for mentorship, but most of you have the skills right now and some on-the-job training. There are some courses and things, but you're going to get better at it, like most things, by doing it more, making some mistakes, learning from your mistakes, and, you know, a couple other things: the patient-physician relationship, challenges and patient satisfaction, generational differences, which continue to be a play from generation to generation of surgeons, and this transition away from what I would call traditional surgical values that, you know, kind of I was exposed to early in my generation to kind of the way we approach things now. These are some of the differences with our contemporary mentorship trying to provide an empowering sense, partnering with our mentees, providing inspiration, both in terms of day-to-day work, but also long-term career goals, which is both are what's important. Letting go, taking the training wheels off, which has to happen at some point, in providing a liberating experience in education and looking at the future. Some other problems, which were well-defined by Moeller and the American College Surgeon Journal, bulletin. So there's obviously less tolerance of this technical learning curve, which plays out into how we use simulation and how we interface without patients first in different ways, animal labs and things, because it is different than it used to be, where it was the see one, do one, teach one. That there is a technological generation gap, as simple as some aspects of learning to work the medical records together during the day, signed off, handoffs. The current training environment is an evolution. Competencies, and then this past July, the implementation of NAS, when we're really looking at competency-based assessment and progression of residency programs, is going to change this relationship, because we're going to have trainees at different places at different times of the same residency program who are going to have different mentorship needs. Faculty will have to adjust to that. Obviously, demands, you know, for the three-legged stool or the four-legged stool of all the things that we're supposed to do to be productive, to make promotion, and to set yourself up for other opportunities in the future. There's only X amount of time during the day. And ultimately, that all occurs in this increasing background of total appropriate conversation with work-home balance and kind of making all that work. So, you know, there are a fair amount of demands, and mentorship should be one of them. So everybody's exhausted at the end of the day. And that's usually the time where we schedule mentor meetings and things. So you have to look at this as prioritizing this like many of the other things you prioritize in your academic life. So two really important questions to close. First is, why is active mentoring a surgery and surgery subspecialty residents important? Well, you're sitting there here at Surgical Grand Rounds, you know, obviously to teach surgery, right? Well, maybe not. So this is a really interesting paper by Kim in the American Journal of Surgery, and this is done as a randomized controlled trial. Took a basic surgical skill in the lab setting, and you had a surgeon teach it and a non-surgeon technician teach it. And ultimately, there was no difference in performance of the skill, whether the surgeon taught it or the technician taught it. Now, obviously, this is a basic surgical situation, one skill. It's not, you know, non-surgeon teaching a Whipple versus, but the message here is that is teaching surgery is one part of what we do. It's an important part of what we do, but it's only one part of developing academic surgeons. So look at this as one component of the compendium that you offer. Jamie McCord here is a surgery resident in the Journal of Surgical Research, looked at 99 UW graduates, you know, with an 84% success rate in getting them to respond to the survey, which is pretty incredible, which means you're engaged and invested in your program if you're responding to a survey at that rate. 75% noted that their mentor was important in their career choice, so 3 out of 4 wouldn't surprise you. What's really interesting is 72%, almost that same percentage, ended up in the same field as their mentor. So as the MIS folks are sitting here thinking, I want to train MIS fellows to do what I do in transplant and trauma and ENT and general surgery, there is a significant relationship between the mentor relationship you develop with your learner and their career choices. Key things noted in that survey, expertise, that goes without saying. We got that all over in spades here in the room. Role model, equally important. And again, mentor and role model are not the same thing, but they are fairly inextricably linked. It's going to be unlikely someone is a really excellent mentor and a suboptimal role model and vice versa. And then professional integrity, which is just critical to how you're viewed by people who look up to you. And then I'd say the key take-home point of this whole paper, though, was that 62% of people identified their mentor at a PGY 2 or 3 level. So if you're kind of thinking you're going to invest in the chief resident and convert them to your thing, that's not what the data from UW would suggest. So getting early formal and informal mentor relationships at the beginning of training is going to have a significant impact. Flint, also an orthopedic surgeon, the key point here, looked at mentorship. And so these were 3,600 orthopedic residents, so nice survey. 50% had some formal mentor program, and you can see over 50% were highly satisfied or satisfied with their environment. So if you really look critically at resident surveys, you know, whether the one that's open in the ACGME now that everybody should do, or surveys done internally as you look at what happens within programs, you know, 50% plus high satisfaction rate here is pretty significant. And what they noted here, which is that programs that had formal mentor expectation delivered a higher satisfaction rate around amongst the residents. So people kind of drift and find their person, but some program that sets up formal relationships within residencies are helpful. So final piece, which affects in multiple ways our students who tend to sit in the back to be close to the coffee, I think. So why is mentoring medical students critical for success in surgical residency programs, and who should do it? And, you know, this isn't necessarily what it looks like on the surface, as you all have your, well, I know what the answers to those are. So Jackie O'Haron, again, a general surgery resident here in American Journal of Surgery, looked at this. And so looking at medical student recruitment and retention into general surgery. So if you remember, this is a little over 10 years ago where general surgery had a couple matches that they didn't completely match and kind of did a soul-searching exercise to try to figure out how can surgery match better. Early exposure of students to positive role models, exposure to academic opportunities, not unlike what we did in our residency in the transition. Exposure to surgery residents as teachers and surgery residents as role models. And I'm going to stress this because I think a lot of time the faculty kind of envision that they're the mentors and the residents don't quite identify themselves as mentors. In fact, I'm going to show you a couple papers to show that the mentors relationship may be the most important between the residents and the students. Obviously, exposure to surgery and kind of quality and extent of exposure, not necessarily the number of cases. We were really interested in this in plastic surgery. Carolyn Rogers in our program, we surveyed all the applicants to plastic surgery a couple We sent the survey out after the match list went in, and we pulled it back before match day, so we had as much of an unbiased sample as we could get. And so we looked at applicant demographics in plastic surgery. You know, 42% had at least a peer-reviewed publication. One in six had a grant. One in four had presented at a national meeting. These are all as medical student applicants. And it was really interesting because what popped out of the survey was if you had a residency at your institution, you were statistically much more likely to match. And that probably is not surprising because that is this mentor relationship that led to writing papers, presenting, having a grant. And then, as we all know, the conversation that goes on between programs, academic surgery is a small group of people. And so those phone calls, those letters, the person you bump into at a meeting that you help facilitate the career of your trainees. What was really interesting, we asked, but not surprising, but it was nice to see it as data, Carolyn asked, so what encouraged you to apply to a specific program? And it was really mentor relationships. So it was reputation of the current program that people get from other applicants, but they predominantly get from their mentor. Interaction with the program director, so that's assessment of the new mentor. Recommendation of their advisor, you know, which may be a faculty person or not, who is their current mentor, and then, you know, things that are important statistically that popped up were interaction with the residency coordinator, quality of email communication, and then geographic preference, which, while that doesn't affect mentor, does affect people's decision making. Jackie, in another paper, looked at this concept of, so what about the third-year rotation in surgery? And so at a pre-clerkship assessment here in this paper published just over 10 years ago, 7% of the students expressed an interest in a surgical career. Post-clerkship, 40% expressed more interest, 15% less, and 37% no change. So there is not much of a question. If you have a well-structured student experiment, in student exposure to surgery, that leads to some more interest. And then it is be kind of hooving on us to lead that into attracting people into surgery and helping them develop to be the best they can be. Looking at the statistics here, you know, these were statistically significant for cases they saw, cases they scrubbed on, but more importantly, and I have them here at the end, both faculty and resident interaction. So I just don't want the residents to underestimate their impact on student career decision making. And I don't want the students to underappreciate how important the residents are to some of their thought processes. And the only negative here, again, a p-value less than 0.05, was the number of hours we spend during our day if you're doing what you love. Jackie, in this paper, hours in the rotation, and the resident interaction flipped on both sides. A negative resident interaction led to a negative perspective of surgery and a negative surgical experience, where on the positive side, cases, resident faculty interactions really panned out very strongly. And if you noticed statistically, the resident faculty interactions had an equal amount of impact on students. Rachel Calcutt, again, in her surgery residency here in her research rotation, looked at influences, and positive influences felt to be an exposure to surgical research. So whether it's a Shapiro student you work with after the first year who morphs into a surgery applicant and surgery resident or subspecialty resident, role model exposure, which we've talked about in different ways, and then the preclinical year introduction. It's really important for surgeons to be involved in the curriculum. There are opportunities at PDS 1, 2, 3, 4, part of ethics course, their anatomy, this pro section. There are just a lot of opportunities. Faculty should become progressively involved in these early preclinical exposures so that students get to see surgeons at work and dispel some of what I would say are some of the image issues that we work with. Nguyen, American Journal of Surgery, looked at residents as mentors, and this is outside of here, but you know, the residents do provide one of the earliest exposures to clinical surgery, both time of day and during rotations. And the time frame, and this is about time, as we talked about in the limitations, the time that residents and student interactions occur by definition is broader than what the faculty and student interactions will occur. And in this paper, significantly, and you can see with a really low p-value, the resident teaching skills were valued, resident attitude, their ability to inspire, provide empathy, provide encouragement, feedback, and supervision that, you know, we commonly lumped into the faculty category, the resident interaction here, statistically significant impact on student education and their future direction. Hernandez kind of wrote a nice little piece in the Bulletin, ACS, also using a resident as a medical student mentor, and, you know, looked at it as the students benefited. That's kind of obvious. The mentor benefited because that's an opportunity to dive in and begin to develop mentorship skills when it's important, when it counts, but before you might be measured in a faculty development way. Fellow residents benefited, programs benefited because people were attracted to programs, institutions, and you can see this kind of positive swell that came out of this. And he felt like this is really the key thing, talking to students and try to offer motivation. Again, this empowerment and encouragement piece, which is not the way surgical education and surgical mentorship was necessarily even 25 years ago. Self-confident, teaching by example, which is always the strongest way to teach, counseling with experience, and then helping raise performance across the book. Whitaker, in this kind of just one of the closing papers here, you know, we do this, and this is was published, and we were doing it long before this, having a formal clerkship director, you know, educational parameters in terms of not expecting people to absorb them no differently than we teach technical skills. Student awards for residents, which we celebrate every year at the Rickers. And you know, everybody has a really strong skill set. There are people that this is what they do. They may not be R01 researchers, but investing in the next generation is going to be their contribution. Recognizing that, just like we recognize research, is going to be important. And then ultimately a structured way of providing feedback, which we all get. My personal view, you know, kind of pulling this together, it's really hard work. It's a little like parenting, incredibly satisfying. You know, there's nothing that is quite as important that we do day to day as we take care of our patients, which is our number one focus, than helping the next generation develop. I think there are people who are good at this and kind of natively born that way. That's the congenital piece. We all can get better at this with work, some training, and some experience and learning from mistakes. No question, availability and need are inversely related. About the time my mentee needs something happens to be the day that you're double booked in clinic and things, and you got to figure it out. And it's a priority no different than your surgical prioritization and how you work that in. I think that this role is important in surgery. I think in most medical schools, the surgeons are kind of out there and maybe not the most positive role modeling before they get and hear of surgeons before you get the rotation, I think, and the students can weigh in at the end of the year and their sign out. But I think that most people are positively surprised by the quality of people, the mentorship, the way people are treated in surgery. I think it's not what the students generally tend to accept. I think it's key for our future. We got to recruit the best and the brightest, provide mentorship. And once they're here, just like you have a donor who becomes engaged, the key is to continue the stewardship part and develop our trainees to help them be the best they can be and move on to the next level, which should be the goal of everyone in academic surgery. If your goal is to have impact personally and you want to have impact in some way of surgery, you will have X amount of impact as an individual. As you start developing mentees as part of your academic life, you know, the multiplier effect of your mentees going out impacting other people is much stronger than you're going to have as an individual contribution. Osler, you know, talked about medicine being an art. It's not a trade. It's a calling. I think we all do that pretty well, and I think having students, residents, fellows see how that happens in a day-to-day world and how you handle the positive and the negative goes with that is kind of important in terms of their learning. But I would suggest, particularly if, as you sit there, and again, if you're an applicant, a senior faculty, junior faculty, fellow, resident, student who will have people they mentor, it's really kind of what you do by example is going to be how you lead in addition to the structured exercises that you pursue in mentorship. I think we're fortunate to have a lot of committed mentors here and excellent learners. I consider myself wanting to be an excellent learner and trying to be a better mentor. And I think by recognizing our weaknesses in this, we'll get better. So thank you for your attention.